Just been bad teams and grinding failure. A different vibe in Wrigleyville this year, however. Gary Miller has tonight's cover story.
It's not so far to hit one out of Wrigley Field, but it's taking several generations to get a World Series title in there. Back in 1908, the Wright brothers were learning to fly. The Cubs have been grounded ever since.
There wasn't a day last year where I wasn't reminded, any day I walked through the stands or anywhere I went, that there were a lot of people that, you know, they felt the time, their clock was ticking, and they hadn't been there yet, and they expected to go there before they went on to the great beyond, and they were holding me responsible for that.
50 years after Norman Rockwell authored this Saturday Evening Post cover, the paint's still fresh.
This one guy said to me, I'm a Cub fan. I'm a third generation. Been Cub fans since 1908, the last time. We know the last time the Cubs won a World Series was 1908. But any team can have a bad century.
Hall of Fame broadcaster Jack Brickhouse grew up a Cub fan in Peoria and started calling their games in 1940. Phil Cavaretta lived on the north side and would either have his favorite cop sneak him in or clean the park to earn a 50-cent seat.
You go under a stand and fill up his gunny sack with whatever was there, and when it was full, you would go give it to the manager, and there in return, he would give you a free ticket to see the Cubs play. And we would sit up in the grandstand and watch the Cubs play. Gabby Hartman, Billy Herman.
In 1935, an 18-year-old Cavaretta left high school to play for the Cubs and made it to the World Series and lost.
It's something that you truly don't forget about it. I only wish we could have won, but we were beaten by a better team.
As World War II ended, Cavaretta was the National League MVP, and Andy Pasco was a Cub. Not only were they unable to end the 37-year-old drought, little did they know 1945 would be the team's last World Series.
I felt sorry for guys like Banks and Santo and Williams, who deserved to be in the World Series, and unfortunately never had that opportunity like I did.
When Leo came with the ball club in 66, and I remember the statement, it seemed like it was yesterday, we finished eighth, and he said, we're not an eighth-place ball club. That year, we finished 10th.
My kind of town, Chicago is the Wrigleyville in Chicago is my kind of town that won't let you down. It's my kind of town.
That 69 ball club is still the most discussed club. That one is remembered and talked about more than the pennant winners.
It could not have cracked so coldly if the Cubs hadn't captured Chicago's heart so completely. After 155 days at number one came the September curse at Shea.
I'm watching this cat come from underneath the stands, walks right around me and goes right back to the dugout, and there's Leo sitting there, and he looks right at Leo and then goes underneath the stand. Now you tell me if that wasn't an omen.
I actually cried. Gosh, sometimes when you have your things in the bag and the bag breaks and you don't make it, because this is my last chance to get into a playoff. But it was a real sad time. I had to have some solitude to myself.
Those 69 Cubs came around again in 1984.
When the playoffs started, a lot of those guys were there, and I remember them coming up and thanking us, you know, thank you for getting that off our back, that the Cubs finally won a pennant. And even though we didn't make it to the World Series, that was a very special year.
Bill Buckner had been traded to make room for Leon Durham, not their only connection.
With him, ground ball hit to Durham, right through his leg! Here comes Martinez! We're tied at three!
Somebody once said to me, does it take a little bit out of you every time you see the Cubs lose?
Yeah.
And I said, if it did, there wouldn't be anything left for me.
The Cubs would come up short again in 1989, with Fitz Williams providing some postseason foreshadowing. Wild things happen. Black Cat, Leo the Lion, even the Curse of the Philly Goat, cast by its namesake tavern owner in 1945, despite numerous attempts to remove it.
He bought a seat for the Goat for the World Series, and they wouldn't let him in, so we put the curse on him. And of course, nothing good has happened to him since. So
the hardest thing about being a Cub was, for myself, was not playing in a World Series.
They used to say no team could win a championship playing all its games in the daytime. They had lights in 1989, and they still lost to the Giants. So what is it? Why has this team been in hibernation from a title going on 90 years?
I've always felt, Gary, when I joined the Cubs, that we were the most philanthropical team in all the sports in the world. We believe in giving rather than receiving.
It might simply be that the Cubs' most endearing aspect is their greatest enemy. Wrigley Field is a park so beautiful, some don't really care if they win or lose. Perhaps a 1969 Ron Santo victory leap could break the spell.
If the Cubs make it to the World Series,
will
you do?
I'll run out there and click my heels as many times as I can.
Naked?
No, not naked.
I love my Cubbies, but not that much.
This is Elena. She's 2 years old. And just like my mom poisoned my mind, I'm going to poison hers. That's how come the Cub fans keep going from generation to generation, because we make them.
Another guy said, being a Cub fan is like being in love with a beautiful girl. The meaner she treats you, the harder it is to let loose of her.
There's always tomorrow. See, I say, I'm 96. If they have time, I've got time. I can wait and whatever. But not forever.
I hope they win it in my lifetime, because I haven't got much time left.
In the 90 years since their last World Series title, they've played almost 14,000 games, and surprisingly, they've only lost 40 games more than they've won. But when it comes to winning World Series games, well, that's another story. The Cubs have won just 9 games in 7 World Series. Their last serious shot was back in 84 when they lost that NLCS to the Padres 3-2.